ago, I went and saw Brene Brown speak on her recent book tour on, the book is called Braving the Wilderness, and inside the book, she included this little card with a quote on it. It says, "Stop walking through the world looking for confirmation that you don't belong. You will always find it, because you've made that your mission. Stop scouring people's faces for evidence that you're not enough. You will always find it, because you've made that your goal. True belonging and self-worth are not goods. We don't negotiate their value with the world. The truth about who we are lives in our hearts. Our call to courage is to protect our wild heart against constant evaluation, especially our own. No one belongs here more than you." Her book and this quote really hit home to me because I'm constantly battling this fight that I don't belong, that I attend events and I have to prove that I'm technical, that I have value to the organization, to the conference, to whoever it is that I'm speaking to. And it's exhausting, constantly having to battle these fights. This talk is from my perspective. You may have a different perspective. That doesn't mean that I'm right and you're wrong, but we have to see things through other people's eyes. We have to see from their perspective to understand and to influence change in our organizations and in the world. A lot of people today have talked about bias. And bias is a really interesting subject because lately in society, we've gotten to a point where bias is a negative thing. And bias isn't negative. Everybody is biased. And if you think that you're not biased, that itself is a bias. It doesn't matter what you're talking about. We all have biases. There's over 180 different biases that are identified. I'm not going to list them all to you, but there's some really interesting ones out there. My favorite is the IKEA effect, where we put more value in something we build because we made it ourselves. So you can maybe buy like a $10 bookshelf at IKEA, and then when you go to sell it, you try to sell it for $20 because you actually put it together yourself, and so there's value in that. There's not much value in that. So biases exist because we're dealing with this environment where we have too much information that we have to deal with. We don't have enough time to explore and understand things. There's not enough meaning in what we're given, so we're trying to make meaning, we're trying to make sense of the information that's provided to us. And our memory is finite. I don't know about you, but I joke with people that like as soon as I learn a new piece of information, something else has flown out of the back of my head. It's like I just can't remember that anymore. Through these biases, we create stories, we create narratives, we try to come up with ways that make things easier. And these biases lead to these exclusionary principles. So I'm going to talk about some of my experiences and what we can do to combat these biases. And it's not easy because it is so ingrained in who we are because we're trying to make things easier on ourselves. So first is to look beyond the label. All of these people are technical. Anybody with this title in your organization is technical. If you sit there and say, I want to talk to somebody technical, and you're talking to a product manager, or you're talking to a sales engineer, that's really insulting to the person. Because in order to work in tech, you have to be technical. I'm looking at changing my title at work because it says product marketing. And I write articles and I submit them to publications and I'm told, you're in marketing, we can't publish what we wrote. We really like what you wrote, but our audience won't read content from somebody with a marketing title. I'm like, then don't put my title on there. Don't ask me what my title is. What I write, what I have to say should have value outside of what my title is. It seems to have like instant credibility if you add the word engineer. So you can be a product marketing engineer and all of a sudden you've elevated yourself. You could work in community. If you call yourself a community engineer, you've all of a sudden elevated yourself. I had somebody tell me at a conference this week after hearing me talk that You totally should add engineer to your title. You've earned it. What do you mean earned it? I don't want to be an engineer. I didn't go into engineering for a reason. In March, I wrote this article on 18 women in tech. And I intentionally went out and spoke to people who are not engineers and do not work in operations. These are non-traditional roles, but they are all women who identify as women in tech. Within an hour of this blog being posted, I had HR send me an email saying, we really like the article, but next time you do something like this, please include some of the female engineers at our company. I included myself and two other women at the company. None of them engineers, but the engineers felt it a slight that they weren't included. It wasn't everybody in the company. I picked three. The intention was not to be about engineers. Be able to recognize and applaud those that aren't writing code, that aren't supporting the systems, that are supporting what we do on a daily basis. The words we use matter. I worked at a company and they had a patent program. Anybody could apply and say, this is an idea and I think we should create a patent around it. And every time the CTO presented, he'd be very clear that this is open to anybody. But every single time a non-engineer was up there, he would make a joke. Like, oh look, we even have smart people in sales. We even have smart people in marketing. Because he thought it was funny to say, they're smart people because they submitted a patent idea. You know what? You have to be smart in whatever role you're in. So don't think that, oh, this is the smart people. That's not the way it works. Earlier this year, there was an interesting article on hacker archetypes. And I really liked it. And they got to this section and they talked about translators. And they said this wasn't a section that they originally had in the article, but through feedback, they added it. And a translator is somebody that bridges the business and the technical side, that they're able to see things in a lot of different ways and communicate with a lot of different organizations and individuals. They're the bridge between humans and machines. It's a very valuable role. And I really liked it until I got to this part of the description. They need to understand their technical limitations and mostly leave the hard decisions to types that naturally swim in deeper technical waters. I can tell you that as a non-technical person, I'm technical, I still make really hard decisions. This makes it sound like, oh, you don't worry your pretty little head, we'll take care of this for you. I don't believe they meant it that way, but these words definitely hurt reading them. We all have shared experiences. As a woman in tech, even though I don't write code, I experience the same things that an engineer experiences. I go to trade shows and I am told I need to speak to the most technical person in the booth and they walk past me. And they're brought back a few minutes later by one of my coworkers and says, she's the one that needs to answer your questions, and they look all sheepish. So it's like, oh, sorry, didn't mean that. I love and hate this chart at the same time. This has been going around for a while on Twitter, that five-minute meeting with a developer. Cross out developer. I don't care what your role is. If somebody is working, if they're productive and you interrupt them, everybody is going to go through this. This isn't something special to developers. Part of my job is to write. I have to block out an entire day in my calendar so that meetings don't get scheduled so that I can be productive. I don't address email. I don't answer phone calls. I turn my chat off because if I don't get anything written. So I would love, when I have time, to recreate this and just cross off developer. This interruption happens to everybody. This is not a unique thing. Look for role models and mentors outside of somebody you may think of as your discipline. So if you're a developer, look for role models, mentors outside of engineering. I am shocked, and it shouldn't be, but I am still shocked when I have people that I've worked with for years that come back to me and refer to me as like a role model and mentor. And I see these people as more successful and more technical and more talented than I am, but they're like, but what you do and the way you do it, they're like, I want to be able to write the way you do. I want to be able to explain ideas the way you do. You can learn from other disciplines. You can learn from other people. Every single, I think this is from a woman's perspective, but I would still replace woman with person. Every single person can be a role model to somebody else, whether you realize it or not. Get involved. Find your area of expertise and share it. And if there's somebody that has an area of expertise that you want to do better in, talk to them, even if they're not an engineer. We have to get past this idea that it's us versus them. We are all in this together. This isn't a game, right? We're all on the same team. We shouldn't be fighting to prove that we belong, that we're valuable. If we can get past that needing to belong and the constant fighting, we'll be so much more productive as humans and as organizations. There's research out there now that shows highly diverse teams are significantly more successful. And that diversity isn't just in race and gender, but it's in different disciplines as well. If you start bringing other people in, sharing their ideas, you end up having more success as an organization. I love what I do. I'm good at it. I've been doing it for a long time. I'm tired of battling and having to prove that I'm technical and I belong. Thank you. Yeah.